Harper Audio presents The Happiness Project, or Why I Spent a Year Trying to Sing in the Morning, Clean My Closets, Fight Right, Read Aristotle, and Generally Have More Fun, by Gretchen Rubin. Read by Gretchen Rubin. Copyright 2009 by Gretchen Rubin. Production copyright 2010 by HarperCollins Publishers. A note to the listener. A happiness project is an approach to changing your life. First is the preparation stage, when you identify what brings you joy, satisfaction, and engagement, and also what brings you guilt, anger, boredom, and remorse. Second is the making of resolutions, when you identify the concrete actions that will boost your happiness. Then comes the interesting part, keeping your resolutions. This book is the story of my happiness project, what I tried, what I learned. Your project would look different from mine, but it's the rare person who can't benefit from a happiness project. To help you think about your own happiness project, I regularly post suggestions on my blog, and I've also created a website, the Happiness Project Toolbox, that provides tools to help you create and track your happiness project. But I hope that the most compelling inspiration for your happiness project is the book you're listening to. Of course, because it's the story of my happiness project, it reflects my particular situation, values, and interests. Well, you might think, if everyone's happiness project is unique, why should I bother to read about her project? During my study of happiness, I noticed something that surprised me. I often learn more from one person's highly idiosyncratic experiences than I do from sources that detail universal principles or cite up-to-date studies. I find greater value in what specific individuals tell me worked for them than in any other kind of argument. And that's true even when we seem to have nothing in common. In my case, for example, I would never have supposed that a witty lexicographer with Tourette syndrome, a 20-something tubercular saint, a hypocritical Russian novelist, and one of the founding fathers would be my most helpful guides. But so it happened. I hope that listening to this account of my happiness project will encourage you to start your own. Whenever you listen to this, and wherever you are in the right place to begin. Getting started. I'd always vaguely expected to outgrow my limitations. One day, I'd stop twisting my hair and wearing running shoes all the time and eating exactly the same food every day. I'd remember my friends' birthdays, I'd learn Photoshop, I wouldn't let my daughter watch TV during breakfast. I'd read Shakespeare. I'd spend more time laughing and having fun. I'd be more polite. I'd visit museums more often. I wouldn't be scared to drive. One April day, on a morning just like every other morning, I had a sudden realization. I was in danger of wasting my life. As I stared out the rain-spattered window of a city bus, I saw that the years were slipping by. What do I want from life anyway? I asked myself. Well, I want to be happy. But I had never thought about what made me happy or how I might be happier. I had much to be happy about. I was married to Jamie, the tall, dark, and handsome love of my life. We had two delightful young daughters, 7-year-old Eliza and 1-year-old Eleanor. I was a writer after having started out as a lawyer. I was living in my favorite city, New York. I had close relationships with my parents, sister, and in-laws. I had friends. I had my health. I didn't have to color my hair. But too often, I sniped at my husband or the cable guy. I felt dejected after even a minor professional setback. I drifted out of touch with old friends. I lost my temper easily. I suffered bouts of melancholy, insecurity, listlessness, and free-floating guilt. As I looked out the blurry bus window, I saw two figures cross the street. A woman about my age trying simultaneously to balance an umbrella, look at her cell phone, and push a stroller carrying a yellow slickered child. The sight gave me a jolt of recognition. That's me, I thought. There I am. I have a stroller, a cell phone, an alarm clock, an apartment, a neighborhood. Right now, I'm riding the same crosstown bus that I take across the park, back and forth. This is my life, but I never give any thought to it. I wasn't depressed, and I wasn't having a midlife crisis, but I was suffering from midlife malaise, a recurrent sense of discontent and almost a feeling of disbelief. Can this be me, I'd wonder, as I picked up the morning newspapers or sat down to read my email? Can this be me? My friends and I joked about the beautiful house feeling when, as in the David Byrne song, Once in a Lifetime, we'd periodically experience the shock of thinking, this is not my beautiful house. Is this really it? I found myself wondering and answering, yep, this is it. But though at times I felt dissatisfied that something was missing, I also never forgot how fortunate I was. When I woke up in the middle of the night, as I often did, I'd walk from one room to another to gaze at my sleeping husband tangled in the sheets and my daughters surrounded by their stuffed animals, all safe. I had everything I could possibly want, yet I was failing to appreciate it. Bogged down in petty complaints and passing crises, weary of struggling with my own nature, I too often failed to comprehend the splendor of what I had. I didn't want to keep taking these days for granted. The words of the writer Colette had haunted me for years. What a wonderful life I've had! I only wish I'd realized it sooner. I didn't want to look back at the end of my life or after some great catastrophe and think, how happy I used to be then, if only I'd realized it. I needed to think about this. How could I discipline myself to feel grateful for my ordinary day? How could I set a higher standard for myself as a wife, a mother, a writer, a friend? How could I let go of everyday annoyances to keep a larger, more transcendent perspective? I could barely remember to stop at the drugstore to buy toothpaste. It didn't seem realistic to think that I could incorporate these high aims into my everyday routine. The bus was hardly moving, but I could hardly keep pace with my own thoughts. I've got to tackle this, I told myself. As soon as I have some free time, I should start a happiness project. But I never had any free time. When life was taking its ordinary course, it was hard to remember what really mattered. If I wanted a happiness project, then I'd have to make the time. I had a brief vision of myself living for a month on a picturesque, windswept island where each day I would gather seashells, read Aristotle, and write in an elegant parchment journal. Nope, I admitted, that's not going to happen. I needed to find a way to do it here and now. I needed to change the lens through which I viewed everything familiar. All these thoughts flooded through my mind, and as I sat on that crowded bus, I grasped two things. I wasn't as happy as I could be, and my life wasn't going to change unless I made it change. In that single moment, with that realization, I decided to dedicate a year to trying to be happier. I made up my mind on a Tuesday morning, and by Wednesday afternoon, I had a stack of library books teetering on the edge of my desk. I could hardly find room for them. My tiny office, perched on the roof of our apartment building, was already too crowded with reference materials for the Kennedy biography I was writing, mixed with notices from my daughter Eliza's first grade teacher about class trips, strep throat, and a food drive. I couldn't just jump into this happiness project. I had a lot to learn before I was ready for my year to begin. After my first few weeks of heavy reading, as I toyed with different ideas about how to set up my experiment, I called my younger sister Elizabeth. After listening to a 20-minute disquisition on my initial thoughts on happiness, my sister said, I don't think you realize just how weird you are, but, she added hastily, in a good way. Everyone is weird. That's why everyone's happiness project would be different. We're all idiosyncratic. Maybe, but I just don't think you realize how funny it is to hear you talk about it. Why is it funny? It's just that you're approaching the question of happiness in such a dogged, systematic way. I didn't understand what she meant. You mean how I'm trying to turn goals like contemplate death or embrace now into action items? Exactly, she answered. I don't even know what an action item is. That's business school jargon. Okay, whatever. All I'm saying is your happiness project reveals more about you than you realize. Of course she was right. They say that people teach what they need to learn. By adopting the role of happiness teacher, if only for myself, I was trying to find the method to conquer my particular faults and limitations. It was time to expect more of myself. Yet as I thought about happiness, I kept running up against paradoxes. I wanted to change myself, but accept myself. I wanted to take myself less seriously, and also more seriously. I wanted to use my time well, but I also wanted to wander, to play, to read at whim. I wanted to think about myself so I could forget myself. I was always on the edge of agitation. I wanted to let go of envy and anxiety about the future, yet keep my energy and ambition. Elizabeth's observation made me wonder about my motivations. Was I searching for spiritual growth and a life more dedicated to transcendent principles? Or was my happiness project just an attempt to extend my driven, perfectionist ways to every aspect of my life? My happiness project was both. I wanted to perfect my character, but given my nature, that would probably involve charts, deliverables, to-do lists, new vocabulary terms, and compulsive note-taking. Many of the greatest minds have tackled the question of happiness, so as I started my research, I plunged into Plato, Boethius, Montaigne, Bertrand Russell, Thoreau, and Schopenhauer. The world's great religions explain the nature of happiness, so I explored a wide range of traditions, from the familiar to the esoteric. Scientific interest in positive psychology has exploded in the last few decades, and I read Martin Seligman, Daniel Kahneman, Daniel Gilbert, Barry Schwartz, Ed Diener, Mihaly Csikszentmihalyi, and Sonia Lyubomirsky. Popular culture, too, is bursting with happiness experts, so I consulted everyone from Oprah to Julie Morgenstern to David Allen. Some of the most interesting insights on happiness came from my favorite novelists, such as Leo Tolstoy, Virginia Woolf, and Marilynne Robinson. In fact, some novels, such as Michael Frayn's A Landing on the Sun, Ann Patchett's Bel Canto, and Ian McEwan's Saturday, seem to be the careful working out of theories of happiness. One minute I was reading philosophy and biography, the next, Psychology Today. The pile of books next to my bed included Malcolm Gladwell's Blink, Adam Smith's The Theory of Moral Sentiments, Elizabeth von Arnim's Elizabeth and Her German Garden, the Dalai Lama's The Art of Happiness, and Fly Lady Marla Silly's Sync Reflections. At dinner with friends, I found wisdom in a fortune cookie. Look for happiness under your own roof. My reading showed me that I had to answer two crucial questions before I went any further. First, did I believe it was possible to make myself happier? After all, the set point theory holds that a person's basic level of happiness doesn't fluctuate much, except briefly. My conclusion, yes, it is possible. According to current research, in the determination of a person's level of happiness, genetics accounts for about 50%. Life circumstances, such as age, gender, ethnicity, marital status, income, health, occupation, and religious affiliation, account for about 10 to 20%, and the remainder is a product of how a person thinks and acts. In other words, people have an inborn disposition that's set within a certain range, but they can boost themselves to the top of their happiness range or push themselves down to the bottom of their happiness range by their actions. This finding confirmed my own observations. It seems obvious that some people are more naturally ebullient or melancholic than others, and that at the same time, people's decisions about how to live their lives also affect their happiness. The second question, what is happiness? In law school, we'd spent an entire semester discussing the meaning of a contract, and as I dug into my happiness research, this training kicked in. In scholarship, there is merit in defining terms precisely, and one positive psychology study identified 15 different academic definitions of happiness. But when it came to my project, spending a lot of energy exploring the distinctions among positive affect, subjective well-being, hedonic tone, and a myriad of other terms didn't seem necessary. I didn't want to get stuck in a question that didn't particularly interest me. I decided instead to follow the hallowed tradition set by Supreme Court Justice Potter Stewart, who defined obscenity by saying, "I know it when I see it," and Louis Armstrong, who said, "If you have to ask what jazz is, you'll never know," and A.E. Housman, who wrote that he could no more define poetry than a terrier can define a rat, but that he recognized the object by the symptoms it evokes. Aristotle declared happiness to be the summum bonum, the chief good. People desire other things, such as power or wealth or losing 10 pounds, because they believe they will lead to happiness, but their real goal is happiness. Blaise Pascal argued, "All men seek happiness. This is without exception. Whatever different means they employ, they all tend to this end." One study showed that all over the world, when asked what they want most from life and what they want most for their children, people answered that they want happiness. Even people who can't agree on what it means to be happy can agree that most people can be happier according to their own particular definition. I know when I feel happy. That was good enough for my purposes. I came to another important conclusion about defining happiness, that the opposite of happiness is unhappiness, not depression. Depression, a grave condition that deserves urgent attention, occupies its own category apart from happiness and unhappiness. Addressing its causes and remedies was far beyond the scope of my happiness project. But even though I wasn't depressed, and I wasn't going to attempt to deal with depression in my framework, there remained much ground to cover. Just because I wasn't depressed didn't mean that I couldn't benefit from trying to be happier. Having determined that it was possible to boost my happiness level, and that I knew what it meant to be happy, I had to figure out how, exactly, to make myself happier. Could I discover a startling new secret about happiness? Probably not. People have been thinking about happiness for thousands of years, and the great truths about happiness have already been laid out by the most brilliant minds in history. Everything important has been said before. Even that statement. It was Alfred North Whitehead who said, "Everything important has been said before." The laws of happiness are as fixed as the laws of chemistry. But even though I wasn't making up these laws, I needed to grapple with them for myself. It's like dieting. We all know the secret of dieting. Eat better, eat less, exercise more. It's the application that's challenging. I had to create a scheme to put happiness ideas into practice in my life. Founding father Benjamin Franklin is one of the patron saints of self-realization. In his autobiography, he describes how he designed his virtues chart as part of a bold and arduous project of arriving at moral perfection. He identified 13 virtues he wanted to cultivate: temperance, silence, order, resolution, frugality, industry, sincerity, justice.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.